This episode is going to be all about Leiftech. Hey guys, so you've probably seen my other videos on this Leiftech board, all the different places I've gone. For example, I've ridden by the ocean, near the river, in parks, in parking lots, through large streets, through small streets, and you've probably seen me ride through some rice fields. So as I ride all throughout Japan, I get a lot of questions on what's that board? In this video, I wanted to do a full breakdown on my experiences with the Leiftech board. Don't worry, this is not a paid advertisement. I'm gonna tell you everything based on my experiences for the last 6 months. The good and the bad. I'll break this review down in several parts. Feel free to check the description below to skip to the relevant parts. 1. What is Leiftech? 2. What's the ride like? 3. Maintenance. 4. Support. And 5. My final thoughts. Alright, let's take this board out and get into the nitty gritty. So let's get into it. What's Leiftech? Leiftech is an electronic skateboard that's a bit different than most skateboards. What separates Leiftech between other electric skateboards is that it has these two center caster wheels that sits in the center of the board alongside with outside four wheels, and it allows you to slide and carve like you were on a snowboard, but it lets you do it on the street. It's easily controlled by this Bluetooth remote, and it runs on these detachable batteries. As you get better riding the Leiftech board, what you'll find is that you end up riding on these center wheels. It's like riding on these inline skates. The outer wheels are mainly used for balance, carving, and sliding, and stopping. Let's go check out this board. When you first get the board, you don't get it like this. You actually have the bindings removed. And there's a reason for that. Because when you're first riding the board, you tend to fall a lot because, you know, you're riding on the center wheels. You don't want to be strapped to the board while you fall or when you fall. But as you get better, then these bindings actually help you turn the board like this. Also, when you first get the board, you actually have these risers installed. These risers sit right here on the actual board itself. And what it does is it pushes up the outer wheels, so there's less of a difference between the center wheels and the outer wheels. When you have a little more balance, it's kind of like riding training wheels on a bike. But as you get better, then you take out these risers, which allows you to rock more than when the risers are in, so it's easier to actually slide. So you guys might be wondering what this protector here is on the outside of the board, in the front and the back of the board. Some of the guys on the forum showed me that you can actually buy this protector for your board and it just wraps around. Mainly the reason I have it is because, you know, when you carry your board, it usually rests on the bottom of the board or the top of the board. So it just protects it. As you can see here, this is from me just putting the board on the ground and it just protects it. You know, I've seen other people with a board and what will happen is, you know, this will get dinged up and you want it just to have a longer life. I'll leave a link in the description below so that you guys can check them out as well for your electric skateboard. Let me show you how to connect the battery, to connect the Bluetooth remote so that we can start going and ride this thing. So the first thing you want to do is pop this guy open. Open up the battery lid, put the battery inside. Usually what I do is I connect the batteries first, connect the second connector in, tuck in the cables, get these straps, and just tie it down like that, and this guy, and then you put the battery lid just like that. Now, the board actually doesn't come with the Velcro straps. I put it on because these clips tend to break, and this is actually my second battery cover. I got the first one replaced because the clips broke, and so what I do is just for reinforcement, I put a Velcro strap on them just like this. The last thing you want is the battery flying out while you're riding this board. That would be a disaster. All right, and all you have to do is press this center button here, and it'll flash green for a second, and then once it flashes blue here and flashes blue here, then you know that the board is connected. So to go, all you have to do is press the trigger to engage the signal, and then press forward to accelerate, and press back to engage the brakes. And now it's time to ride. So, if your wheels aren't aligned, you're not going anywhere. When the board starts, you're gonna have to align the wheels. If the wheels aren't aligned, the board isn't gonna start, or it's gonna make stuttering noise. So what you need to do is to always make sure the caster wheels are moving forward in one straight line. They can actually be going like this in the same angle and it'll work, but just as long as the two wheels are aligned facing the same direction. You don't actually need a push start. You can actually start with just the wheels aligned, but it takes extra battery powers, like this. The wheels are now aligned. So what you want to do in this situation is do a push start, because when you do a push start, it actually aligns the wheels so that they're all going the same direction. So once you start going, it's a blast. You can do spinning, sliding. It's just like you're riding a snowboard. Let's talk about sliding and braking. So there's two ways to stop. There's regenerative braking, and two, there's slide stops. The Leiftech board, like many of the other electric boards, come with regenerative braking. What that means is when you hit the brakes on the controller, it charges the battery during the time you're braking. I used to use this feature a lot when I first got the board because it was just a very easy way to stop. As I got better, I stopped using and just relied on the outer wheels to slide and stop. The only problem I found when you do the braking is that now you're horizontal when you've stopped and you want to start again, you have to realign, go forward, and then you have to do a push start. Kind of annoying, but it's just, you know, it's part of the board. Going up hills. Leiftech advertised that this board goes up hills. The reality is, you can't actually start on the hill. Or, well, maybe you can, but it's very difficult. The reason it's difficult is because, as I mentioned before, you have to do a push start. And when you're on a hill, it's really difficult to do that.
If you've seen some Leiftech videos, you've probably seen them going up a hill.
But they have some speed going up that hill. When you want to go up a hill, you're going to have to build up speed, and you usually want to do that on flat ground. The last thing you want to do is stop on that hill, because it's going to be difficult to start back up. Wait until you get to the top of the hill to stop. If you can, power through the hill and then stop at the top. Otherwise, you're going to have restarting from a full stop midway up the hill. So where to ride this thing? Leiftech report that the board can go 23 miles an hour. Going at that speed, you better make sure that the road is smooth. When I first got this board, I thought, hey, cool, it has these big longboard wheels on the outside so I can go over bumps and cracks really easily, just like a longboard. What I didn't realize, and what I mentioned earlier, is that you're riding pretty much on those center wheels. The center wheels are half the width of the big longboard wheels, so you notice the cracks and the bumps a lot more than those longboard wheels. So let me show you what I mean.
Ready?
Yep.
Set, go. Oh, there's a dog.
Oh.
Hey. Have a good day.
So this road is very, very smooth. It's really good. It's perfect. So this road, it's okay to ride on, but you don't want to ride on this thing for a long time because it's not that enjoyable, but still rideable. So roads like this, way too rough. Would not recommend going over it at all. I mean, you can kind of still go over it, but man, no sliding or anything. You might get in an accident. Be careful, you're warned. So I guess the only thing I have to say is before you buy something like this, because it's, you know, quite a lot of money, is to check whether or not you're actually able to ride it in your city and town. Check the laws. It doesn't hurt. One of the things that you should be careful of is the roads. You're actually sliding a lot of the time, and you're not going straight like a skateboard. You're going left to right, so you want to kind of make sure that your roads are wide enough, because the last thing you want is to get in an accident. So let's talk about battery life. The Leiftech board comes with these detachable batteries. Now, when I first got the board, I got the 1X battery. Personally, I got 30 to 40 minutes of ride time at 5 to 6 kilometers of ride distance. Now, I've recently upgraded and I got the 2X battery. It's roughly the same size, just a little bit thicker than the 1X. With the 2X, I've got about 60 minutes of ride time at 14 kilometers. There's actually a 3X out, but it's not available in Japan. So for now, I'm stuck with a 2X. Sometimes you want to take your Leaf board overseas or on a plane. And when you do that, there's battery limitations. What's nice about the 1X and 2X, they're able to fly. The 2X is 96 watts, so you're able to take it on the plane. Whereas the 3X, I think you're gonna need special permission to take the battery on the plane. Another question you might have is, how heavy is this board? So this board, when loaded up, it's about 9.5 kilos, which is roughly 20, 21 pounds. Let me put it down, it's kinda heavy. The fact that it's so heavy, it's not easily portable. So when you run out of battery life, you're gonna be walking this thing home. What I've done is I've actually found a bag so that I can roll this thing around when I'm getting on trains, when I'm going from point A to point B without riding the board. So let's talk about water. Leiftech claim that the board is water resistant. Oh wait, let me correct that.
True water resistance.
So let me share with you an experience I had with truly water resistance. In the previous ride breakdown, you might have noticed my board made kind of an annoying loud clicking noise. So that's not normal. The water has gotten to the motor bearings and has slightly rusted the bearings. You can see in this previous video as well that it makes this noise. Did you hear that? That's so annoying. I rode my board on wet pavement one time, and ever since then the board has been making this clicking sound. The statement that the board is water resistant, that's probably true, but I guess to what standard? So if you decide to ride in the rain, or even when the ground is a little bit wet, you may have these issues. And the reason I still have these issues... So let's talk about maintenance of the board. Yup, this is one of my center drive wheels. And I'm trying to replace the motor. And yes, this is how you're supposed to replace the motor bearings. And yes, this could happen to you if you decide to ride in the rain or on wet pavement. And yes, I've wasted a lot of my time on maintenance. One of the things I didn't ask when I first bought an electric board was, how much maintenance does it take? Well, the reason I didn't ask was I simply thought it was charge, go, and repeat. I was wrong. There is a lot of maintenance. These are all of the tools I've had to purchase in order to perform maintenance on the board. When I first started, I only had this like IKEA tool set. I had this screwdriver. Oh, and these scissors. Anyways, let me go through the tools that I had to purchase for the last 6 months. But this set here, this set, this set, this set. 3/32 hex, 2.5 millimeter hex, 3 millimeter hex, 4 millimeter hex. Bought this wrench, 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 another wrench,
screwdriver,
Loctite, 3M threadlocker, synthetic grease, super glue, motor bearings, a soldering iron, a second soldering iron. As you can see, it's a lot of tools. Through the course of owning this board, I've pretty much replaced all of the parts. One of the parts is the center drive wheels. And to take off the center drive wheels, you have all these different screws. I've had to replace the center wheel, these pulleys. All of these require tools. Hex tools, also known as like Allen keys, which are these guys. And unfortunately, this board has like a mix of metric and imperial sizes, so I've had to buy two different sizes. When I first bought them, I thought I could just buy any tools. And what I found is that a lot of these tools broke, especially with the smaller Allen keys, because the screws were on so tight that I couldn't get them off. So I had to just keep on buying new ones until I came across a brand called Bondis that actually have pretty good strong tools, but it took me a while to get to these Bondis things because I didn't know that I needed to purchase really high quality tools in order to support this board. Another thing that I had to go through is I purchased a soldering iron. The reason why you need a soldering iron is because you have to get screws out of these pulleys here. You use Loctite in order to lock them down because they slip a lot, and you have to use a soldering iron to get them out in order to heat the screws and get them loose. At first I bought this one, 40 watt, but it didn't work because it wasn't getting hot enough. So then I had to buy a second solder iron. Mind you, I've never actually used these soldering irons other than for trying to maintain my board. You know, I'm not really a mechanical person. I'm not used to working with all these tools. Well, at least I didn't expect that this much maintenance was required. But all right, so let's cut to the chase. I received my board on September 11th. I was super stoked that I got this new board. I wanted to check it out, try it out, and ride it around. The thing was, after riding it for a couple weeks, I started getting some issues here and there. For example, I had an issue with my remote trigger breaking, and I had some more other serious issues like my belts burning out. After all those pulley issues, belt issues, trigger issues, I still had a nagging issue with my motor bearings. So on November 3rd, I opened up a thread on the Leiftech forum. Leiftech have an online forum where riders can share their experiences, give tips about riding or tricks. One of the cool things is that Leiftech support, they're also on the forum so that, you know, they can answer any questions that they have. The community members are super helpful and supportive. It's a pretty awesome site. Shortly after, on November 5th, I had a Skype call with Leiftech support to discuss my issues. One of the issues obviously being my motor bearing, but also I had some issues with my PCB board, my bindings, battery straps, and battery cover clips. After that Skype call, it was cool. I thought I'm gonna be able to resolve my issues really quickly and that they were gonna send me the parts. But unfortunately, that's not what happened. So a few weeks rolled by, so I messaged them again on December 2nd. Luckily, at that time, Leiftech finally responded to me and said that, hey, we're putting all the parts together, we're getting the pulleys together, and we'll send that out to you shortly. Another couple weeks went by, so I sent that reminder on the 15th, no reply. So I waited a few more days, and then I sent out another message on the 20th, and everything was cool up until this point. And then I received a response from a new person from Leiftech support. They told me that they would check on the parts, but then they went off about something completely unrelated and saying that I was the only person to burn out 5 timing belts. It was just really confusing because the issue with the belts had already been resolved with another Leiftech support person. The resolution was to send me an upgraded metal motor pulleys. After that message from Leiftech, still don't have my parts, so I send them another reminder on the 28th. So on January 7th, finally I get another email from Leiftech saying that we're sending out most of the parts. Moving forward to January 11th, they send me a final confirmation that parts are going to be sent out. The interesting thing is, they didn't send them out via your regular delivery service. They actually said, hey, we're sending it out via one of our customers who's stopping by in Japan. This is where I met Adam. Finally received all the parts from Adam. Unfortunately, one of the parts that was missing were the motor bearings. I had to go through this, you know, another couple months trying to sort out the motor bearings with Leiftech because they told me the wrong bearing size, and I ordered the wrong bearing sizes, and so I had to order some more. But eventually we got it sorted out, and now I've got my new bearings, and you saw me earlier trying to hammer them into the motor. Almost there. The moral of this story? I don't know what the moral of the story is. All I can say is I won't be riding my board in the rain or wet pavement anytime soon. Jeez. That whole talk about maintenance and support brought back all these like stressful memories over the last 6 months. So the board is super fun. I've never had so much fun riding a board in my life. Leiftech board is awesome. when it's working.
One of the things about this board is the maintenance sucks. I mean, really sucks. The last 6 months have been very trying. Let's say I haven't thrown out the board out of the window. Buying this board, it almost feels like model airplane. If I imagine, it's like, it seems like it because you take it out and then you perform some maintenance, you take it out again, and so you're constantly performing maintenance on the board every time you take it out. At least in my experience. For me, I prefer something where I could just charge and go, rinse and repeat. You know, I don't really want to worry too much about the board. I just want to ride it. The thing is, you're going to have to deal with Leiftech support.
Support was awesome for the first couple of months. In fact, support was more than I had ever expected. And then after a couple months, it just dropped off. And surprised because support just stopped supporting. As you saw previously, when they did respond, they sounded aggressive.
It felt like, you know, it's my fault that all of these things are happening to the board. I'm just a regular user trying to ride the board. I'm not going off crazy jumps. I'm not bumping into walls, and I'm not trying to push the board past its limits. So moving forward, I'm going to ride the board for another 6 months and we'll see where we are. I'll do another review. I'll let you guys know how I've done with the board, what other issues I've had, if the support improves, just my overall experience in the next 6 months. Hopefully, I don't have as much issues, and hopefully, support get a lot better, but we'll see. If you guys have any questions about the board or about anything that I mentioned in this video, then feel free to leave a question in the comment section below. And also, for those Leiftech riders out there, if you've had the same issues, if you've had different experiences with maintenance as well as support, then also let me know. And for those other riders who have electric skateboards, such as, you know, boosted boards, evolved boards, inboards, if you would recommend your board over the Leiftech board. All right, looking forward to your comments. Talk to you guys soon.